sanctuary was filled with young people of all different races and backgrounds, trying to figure out and trying to make sense of what had happened. And one of the things that they said in their confusion and their anger and their sadness and their disappointment, man, was they looked at those who were of another generation, and I was one of the ones that they looked at, and said, I thought you had figured all this out already. I thought this was already resolved. I thought this was already won. We celebrate, I learned about the civil rights movement in my classes, and I thought this was already won. They looked at me, and many of them 22 and 23 years of age, and I was reminded of the fact that they were 13 and 14 years of age when Barack Obama became president, and people spoke of a post-racial society where it didn't matter, black and white did not matter anymore. And that they had maybe heard those statements during those times and somehow had come to the conclusion that in the world full of evil, that somehow we were going to rid the world of racism. Lord have mercy. And somehow had taken this in to their spirit and they thought it happened. So it was a shock to them to see someone, many people from Eric Gardner to Tamir Rice, the 12-year-old boy shot in the middle of the playground playing with a toy gun. They were shocked to find that this actions and reactions and the attitudes of some people who belittled and made Black Lives Matter. Now, I mind you that everybody there was not black, but the young people were there were saying, who were not black, I stand with my friend. And watching my friend go through this pain. And so as they spoke to me and shared with me, my own frustration became clear, and I had to come to the conclusion that when we talk about civil rights and we talk about all the great things that have happened so many years ago, that if young people cannot be assured of their safety when they're dealing with the people who are paid to protect them, then we have failed. There's something so fundamental about, and people will bring up, other people get shot in the community, and are you concerned about that? And I say, yes, I'm very concerned about that. We deal with that all the time. But there's something about the police officer who is paid to protect you that somehow it hurts so much more when you cannot trust that police officer, or you got to worry or think about trusting that police officer. My son today is going back to school, and my wife might have to, first lady might have to scoot out there to go with him. And it is a concern of ours when he's driving his car in northern New Jersey of how the actions and the attitudes of police officers with him. We sit down and talk to him and try to train him about what to say. Don't lose your anger. Don't get upset, but go along, apply, do what they tell you to do. Smile, go along, but don't risk your life. Don't risk your life, son. Be compliant even when they tell you something that doesn't make sense. And the question is, I got to tell him this, and so many parents and mothers and fathers still have to tell their sons and their daughters this when they're dealing with police, and this seems like a story that should have been played out 50 years ago, but we still are dealing with it today. And so the question comes, are you willing to fight? Because that's really what they were asking me that day. Okay, didn't do what you thought you had done, but are you willing to stand up now? And so when we talk about standing up for justice and fighting for justice, often it's not talked about in the context of stewardship. Stewardship becomes something about, again, money more than anything else when preachers preach about it, and we don't talk about other things, about what God gives us and what God has blessed us with and how we're caring for. me now. Help me. I'm coming to something. And see, what's new, when we say about stewardship, we said our principles is that the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, and that everything belongs to God, and everything is owned by God, and God created everything, and we have created nothing. We talked about that our stewardship principle is that, that therefore, since God owns everything, then we own nothing. And that we own the, therefore, we own the same amount as Donald Trump, which is nothing. We talk about that it's stewardship, then. That stewardship, God gives us things so that we can take care of them. And when he gives us things to take care of, he calls them a blessing. Lord have mercy. And we can look at all the things that we have in our life that God gave us since he owns everything. He blesses us with everything. So we're blessed to wear these clothes. We're blessed to be in this situation. We're blessed to have the car we drive, or the house we live in, or place to stay, or roof over our head. We're blessed by those things. And if we don't have them, and then God gives us to us, we recognize even more that it's a blessing to have all of those things. And but that God is saying, I didn't give it to you. I'm giving you charge over it. And it's your job to care for it. Your job to care for it. And that means if it's your job to care for it, sometimes you gotta fight for it. I'm gonna hear you now. Sometimes, when God gives you a blessing, he gives you charge over it. Somebody comes and mess with your child, you know you're gonna step up and fight for your child. When someone tries to attack your son, or attack your daughter, or attack your family, you know you first went on the scene to protect what God has given you. And sometimes we make the mistake, we'll fight for stuff we shouldn't be fighting over. Lord have mercy. Sometimes we fight with the girl down the street over nothing. Oh, sometimes you fight with the girl down the street over a guy that ain't no good for neither one of you, and God can give you stewardship over that person in the first place. Oh, we fight for a lot of different things. Lord have mercy. We fight for a lot of different things. We'll fight over relationships. We'll fight over money. We'll fight over situations on the job. We'll fight in the school. We'll fight over nonsense. But when it comes to really fighting for things of justice, sometimes we just not on the scene. When it comes to standing up for what God has given us, the right to live free in this country, the right to live and have justice in this country, the right to be able to be free from persecution in this country, and free from oppression in this country, sometimes we not on the scene. We let others fight for us. And then when we wonder when our freedom is taken, we wonder how it got taken. And we look to blame other people instead of looking to ourselves. The young people were right, that should be over. In a town, an African-American, a majority town, in a town with an African-American mayor, an African-American police commissioner, an African-American district attorney, an African-American head of city council, an African-American majority council, an African-American solicitor general, an African-American judges by the law, an African-American in all different situations and places, and still you're dealing with the same thing like it was 50 years ago, something's wrong. Pastor, why do you get so political? Well, this ain't political in Nehemiah, but it is political in Nehemiah. Because in the story of Nehemiah is that he asked the king, he said, give me some resources. My community is disrespected. My community is downtrodden. My community in Jerusalem has been disregarded. My community that I have stewardship over, and one of the stewards over that community is in ill repute. People are disrespecting, ignoring, and abusing my community. And since I'm one of the stewards of the community, King, I need you to help. me to be able to lift up my community. Nehemiah could have stayed up in the palace. Nehemiah could have stayed up in the big place in Babylon and lived a wonderful life and had all of the luxuries that he would ever want. But something in his spirit said, if God makes me steward over the community, then I got to fight for that community. I got to go back and help that community. I can't simply enjoy myself and enjoy my life in the palace. I got to fight for something. And so Nehemiah went back to the community and brought all of the resources he could find and all the resources he could get with the king and started lining up the people and said, are you willing to build this wall right here that they tore down? There was a wall around the city, and the wall around the city was burned down by the enemy. And since the wall was around the city was burned down, anybody could come in and invade them and attack them at any time. So the first thing they had to do to get the city straight was to rebuild the wall so it would not be attacked anytime. And so he asked them, will you build this wall? Will you build this wall? He went to regular folk. He was up in the palace, but he went to regular folk, just like us sitting here. He went to regular folk that were farmers. He went to regular folk that were traders. He went to regular folk that were vendors. He went to regular folk that people that build houses. He went to regular folk and regular situations, dealing with that day-to-day stuff, trying to make it in this world. They were just trying to make it in Jerusalem, trying to survive somehow. And he went to them and said, are you willing to fight? Those people were no different than us here today. They had all of their lives and things that was important for them to do, and they were trying to raise their children and raise their babies and raise their family. They were trying to make it on a little bit of money because they were taxed so much, but they still stopped what they were doing and heard the call to rebuild the walls of Jerusalem so that they could have a better life. They weren't trying to act political. They were simply trying to give a better life for their children. And they knew the only way they could have a better life is if they all work together for the betterment of the community. They knew that they couldn't do it on their own. They knew they didn't have the resources to do it on their own. But if we all work together, then somehow we can build a better life for all of us. Oh, y'all better hear me this morning. That somehow, he went to each one of them and he told them, look, I don't even ask you to build a wall on the other side of town. Just work on the wall that is right in front of your house. Just you know that wall, that one right there, that little ugly eyesore that you got right there in the back of your house. You know the one that's burned down that somebody came and burned down? That one right there. You know the one somebody wrote some graffiti on? That one right there. You know the one that all the bricks have been taken out? That one right there. You know the one that took all the copper out of the house because the drug dealers got all the copper and used the copper to get some drugs? You know the one that no pipes are in no more? You know the one that they took the toilets out? You know that one? That one right there, that's the one you got to build. That's the one you got to be. That little ugly eyesore, you walk by year after year and let it happen. He went to each one of them and said, just work on the wall that's right here. Just work on that. And he got moved. He was happy. He was happy because he brought the resources. So that means there was a longing for them to repair that wall, but they didn't have the resources to. Y'all better hear what I'm saying. Now they wanted to do it, but they couldn't do it because they didn't have resources. He brought the resources and challenged them to build it. So when someone brings you the resources to make a change in your community, you got to take the challenge to be able to build that community and transform that community yourself. You can't wait for somebody. You got to decide to make the change. So they built the wall. And God got my wall. And I know they got encouraged because they looked down the way and saw somebody working on their wall. And on the other side said, there's somebody working on it. I know that name. Hey,
Lord, have we said God is, God must be in this thing if he's working on wall. And you will have some folk that you ain't going to expect when you start to work on your wall that will come to your side that you would never think would ever do it, who will be willing to stand with you in your community because they've just been waiting for the opportunity to make a change. Lord, have mercy. Work on wall. Wall. Okay, I got it. All right, we're good. We're good. We're going to get this wall done good. And I know Nehemiah was excited. He was excited because he's going to get this wall done quick. All of a sudden, the walls are starting to pop up all around the city. All of a sudden, all the walls are coming up and saying, we can make a change. We can make a difference. We can make a change. And then in chapter 4, verse 1, here comes the enemy. Seconds of light. And a few others who had been making money. I ain't talking politics, I'm just telling you how the story goes. They were making money off of their misery. Sanballat, the governor, Sanballat, the leader, who was over them and had the governorship going back to the king, they were making money, they were taxing them and taxing them and taxing them, and they were skimming off the top, giving Babylon some money, keeping some money for themselves. They had a little scam going on. They were making money, and they were living good themselves while the people were suffering. They were living good while people were in misery. They were living good while the people were going down. They were living good while the people were hurting and in need and in pain. They were doing well. They were doing well. Now, I ain't going to even go there with you for the analogy of that. You figure that one out for yourself. When people who are over you seem to be doing well, when Philadelphia is 25% of Philadelphia lives in poverty, and they're up there dancing and having parties and enjoying themselves, and most of the city is in misery. Y'all look at that for yourself. And you haven't seen them speak it in your community. You haven't seen it, except when it's election time. I'm serious. I'm doing the scripture. That's all in the scripture. And so all of that goes on. And they see, now get this, they see them building the wall. They see them building the wall. And they look, these people, they ain't going to build this wall. Them silly people, don't even worry about it. They ain't going to build the wall. You gotta be kidding. That brother down there trying to build a wall, man, that brother can't even build it. He can't even take care of his own house. I ain't gonna try to build a wall. They laugh at him. They said, verse 1, you got verse 1 right there. They mocked him. They made fun of him. Until, verse 7, they saw that the people weren't coming. And they were building this wall. So here's the part of the story that we want to focus on. We're going to just do this and then we're going to stop. But they saw them and they became angry as they were rebuilding and making a better community. Get this. They got angry because the community was getting better. They represented the community and made profit off of the community. So when the community tried to make itself better, they were angry and was trying to figure out a way to stop it. Lord, ever know.
Yeah,
See, you got to understand in this world that there's some people who say that they represent you, some people who supposedly support you, some people who supposed to stand with you, that their interest is elsewhere. They might have the same skin color you have, they might have the same background you have, they may have the same school they went to that you did, they might have the same neighborhood they know, but their interest is not your interest. They're not about the community. They're not about the change in the community. They're only about lining their own pockets. And when you try to make a difference in your community, they will stand up and try to fight you. So then he conspired all of them together to come and fight against Jerusalem. They wanted to hinder him. Yeah, well, that's right in the scripture. Thank you, Sean. That verse 8 is right there. They were supposed to serve him, but they tried to hinder. You've got some folk that try, that say they try to serve you, but they're really trying to hinder you. Lord have mercy. So what do you do? When the people who are supposed to represent you are not representing you, but are actually trying to hinder you. Oh Lord have mercy. Y'all better hear what I'm saying. Nevertheless, so what does he do? What does he do? The first thing he does is the spiritual thing. It says in verse 9, nevertheless, even though they're coming to get me, nevertheless.